Our panel would be talking upon mentors and role models in ecology and conservation. I would like to invite upon stage Dr. Veena Srinivasan from ATREE to introduce the panel and also to moderate the session.
Thanks, Asmita. So today's session is on mentoring and role models in ecology and conservation. And I think since we are here to celebrate Dr. Bawa, I think we have a role model right in front of us. But I think therefore the session was kind of inspired by that. So we have four excellent panelists today. Dr. Savitri Gunatillake from the University of Purabi. We have Purabi Saikia, Dr. Purabi Saikia from Central University of Jharkhand. We have Arundhati Das from NCBS. And Uma Ramakrishnan. So I'm just going to repeat the names then. Savitri Gunatillake from the University of Purandariya. Purabi Saikia from Central University Jharkhand. Arundhati Das from NCBS. And Uma Ramakrishnan couldn't make it today, but Dr. Maria Thaker from ISC very kindly agreed to substitute in her place. So I'd like to welcome all of the panelists on to the stage. So we were joking earlier today that this is an all-woman panel. So we normally talk about manels, and this is a fanel. So I don't know if you guys have heard the term manel, but it's a all-male panel. This is an all-woman panel, and we are all fans of the fanel. So I'm really excited that we have four very... and you can see the women we have range from the entire age span, from early career to a very experienced researcher. So that's exciting. And we were just discussing earlier today about whether, you know, it's a coincidence that we happen to be an all-women panel. And I don't know what that is, but maybe it just turned out that more women agreed than men. And I don't know what that says about mentoring and women. But anyway, welcome to everybody here. So we were going to start the discussion by very quickly having everybody talk about one really successful mentoring experience that they've had. And something that's worked either really well for them, either in their position as a mentor or a mentee. So I thought we'd just go around with a happy story and then get into some of the more serious, yeah?
Oh boy, okay. So I think I've been very fortunate to have had great mentors throughout my training. And my first and I think most formative mentorship engagement began in high school. And it's closely linked to the sound of a motorcycle at 5 a.m. Before I knew what an ecologist was or could be, my high school biology teacher knew that I should be one. And so him recognizing what I could do really shaped the way I view mentorship relationships. He engaged with me to do research, and so I don't know any other high school biology teacher that wakes up at 5 a.m., rides his motorcycle, meets you at the Delhi Ridge to trap rodents. And I'm a high school student. And so I've picked from that experience the kinds of mentors I've wanted. People who listen to me when I speak, people who push me. And so I haven't picked star-studded CVs or fancy universities. I've picked people.
Thanks, Maria. Mine is not particularly one experience, but more of, I was fortunate to have mentors both at the graduate and PhD level who emphasized the importance of communication and being able to communicate the work that you're doing effectively, especially through writing. And just as it was sort of my duty to collect my data in the most rigorous way possible and to do my analysis in the most rigorous way possible, it was also my duty to find the best, most effective way to write clearly, concisely, and in a way that would engage the readers of what I was writing. So I'm very grateful to my mentors for imbibing in me the importance of that, both through their own example, as well as, you know, actively inculcating it in me.
It was an experience I had with my PhD supervisor long years ago, and it was Professor Peter Ashton, who was my supervisor then. I hadn't known him, but it was my head of department who said I should go to him, when already I had made arrangements to go to Oxford, but the head of department said that, and I had no choice, because he said, what we need is an ecologist. And I want to do pathology, and not a pathologist, because they already had one. So overnight, it was ecology and not pathology. And I ended up in Aberdeen University, and that's where I met Peter and Mary and their family, of course. And for the first year, it was discussing with Peter what I should do, following an MSc course and so on. And at the end of it, it was arranged that I go to Sri Lanka, study 5 forests, different climatic zones. And at that point in time, I didn't know what a forest was, except just passing by forests and so on. And I was really nervous. And anyway, I thought, I'm going home. That's a carrot, actually, and I'll be happy there, and so on. And I was very, very nervous about the forest part of it. And then, just before I emplaned, Peter took me to the airport. And just before leaving me, he said, Savi, you are my first graduate student going abroad. And if you are not a success, Aberdeen University will never allow any more students to be supervised at a distance. So that was a really tall order. And I was thinking, even if I don't mind, if I fail becoming a forest ecologist, I still would have a job to do. And then suddenly Peter says this, and it was a big responsibility indeed. So to cut a long story short, I went, as I told you, to Sri Lanka. And 2 weeks after, Peter followed me. And then he helped me select the field sites and discussed various things about sampling and so on. And then he left. But fortunately for me, my head of department then, he had made all the local arrangements for me to go to these different 5 forests. Some I have never been to those areas even. And because of that, I was able to accomplish the work within a year's time and then go back to Aberdeen and finish my thesis. But long years afterwards, I think maybe about 10 years afterwards, like, it so happened that I was speaking with Mary Ashton, his wife, and suddenly it reminded me and about this experience that I had. And they discussed with me that it was Professor Costermans, whom I had met in Aberdeen. And Peter introduced him to me. And I just smiled and I said, yes, I'm happy to meet you, sir. And then it was that. But then about 10 years later, I hear that when Costermans went home with Peter, Costermans had said, Peter, you're making a big mistake. That lady in Lungi, you introduced me to, is never going to do any forest ecology. You will not be a success. And she will not be a success. So that's what happened with Peter. But Peter never said anything. He never said the word. He never told me anything long years afterwards also, except that I think Mary is the one who spilled the beans. And the lesson I learned actually from Peter is that I should, we must not mistrust the students and their potential, because we give them a responsibility and we think, will she do it or will she not do it or he do it or so on. But actually they are much more intelligent and much more committed, and you find that they do beyond your expectations. So at the first few times we meet them, they may not be as good. Then of course, we were very lucky that on our first sabbatical year, that's about 7 years after my PhD, we went back to Peter. That time he was at Harvard. And on that trip, Peter said, there is someone special that I want you to meet. And you can guess who it is. It was none other than Kamal. And then Peter said, I have been associated with Kamal for a long time, but I want you to meet him. And quite quickly, actually, we had the meeting with Kamal. He was invited by Peter. And Peter wanted to do the pollination ecology of dipterocarps in Sri Lanka, because he had already done the Malaysian ones, and he wanted to compare it with Sri Lanka. So dipterocarps are huge trees, and I'm thinking in my head, now are we going to be climbing trees and looking at flowers of dipterocarps? And of course, in the same way, Kamal was very interested in doing some species that at least villagers benefit. So it was very easy, and I was very happy, at least part of the project, that if we ever get it, would be a success for that. But you know, Kamal, his writing is so good. He's the one who applied for the grant and got a big grant. And that's how Daya ended up doing pollination ecology in Sri Lanka, and then went to Kamal and got trained. And we also had non-timber species. And because we were also very keen, because when the Singaraja Reserve was made a protected area, villagers were restricted from going into the forest. And even we were thinking it's very unfair, because they have been using it and collecting the fruit and vines and so on. So we were very happy to do that also, so that we can do restoration work. And in fact, afterwards, we did introduce those species into our restoration plots as well. Now, 25 years later, the shoryas are in bloom, and some of the restoration species are also being harvested by villagers. So that was a nice experience for us.
Really lovely story. Dr. Purabi?
Hello. And before going to start, just I want to keep one statement, like recognizing the intellectual potential of women, it's really a challenging task. And I consider women's are intellect, and who taught me that women's are intellect? I recognize that I am intellect. The man behind this is Professor ML Khan, my mentor during my PhD days. Yes, here we are today to express our own experience towards the great mentorship and role models in ecology. So, of course, Professor K.S. Bawa, he is the role model for every ecologist, because he had inculcated the study of, I can say, like he had started the study of ecology, and he influenced so many ecologists from India and throughout the world to work in the diversified field of ecology. So of course, although he is a role model for everyone, but for me, Professor Khan is, for me, he is not other than Professor Bawa, because of him, I'm getting this platform. I'm wherever I am sitting, I'm always used to say, like, I'm so blessed, because I'm coming from a very rural background of Assam. And when I joined him during 2007 in a DBT-sponsored R&D project, at that time I was technologically, I can say, I was zero. I even don't know how to switch on one desktop. So for even, because my schooling was done in Assamese background, so I was so poor in English, and he is from Lucknow, he used to speak Hindi in a proper way, and even today I am not so fluent in Hindi. So it was a difficult task for me to communicate with Professor Khan, and he's such a huge personality. I was always, when I used to go to him, I used to complete my sentences within a word, like, yes, yes, sir, okay, sir, no, sir, like that. But the big thing in that person is that, means he never used to discourage me, although I was so poor in English, I was so poor in technology, utilization in technology and all. He always used to say, he is so polite person, totally opposite to me, soft-spoken, and he's quite patient, and I'm totally overexcited kind of girl. But he handled me in such a nice way, and he, today he made me like, means, yes, I'm not that much confident, but still I can face any kind of situation, because I always feel like that person is always behind me. And the thing is that when I was nothing, at that time also, he always used to say like, dhimi dhimi sikh jaoge. It means slowly, slowly you will learn everything. And today, I am feeling so proud that he is sitting in front of me. And nowadays, we used to share same kind of dais. Recently, we were there in BHU. We are sharing same stage. So it's quite pleasing. Means that person who taught me to stand up, who taught me to do research in ecology. And when I was doing MSc, at that time I thought like that ecology, what is this? Nothing. Here only ecosystem, biotic, abiotic component, nothing is there. It is this so boring subject. And after meeting him, I thought like that means, and at the very beginning people used to say like that, he is a regeneration and population ecologist. I thought like regeneration, what is this? Nothing else. Means you will put seed, it will germinate and it will grow. I thought like that, what is new in this field? But right now, after working with him since 2007 to last 13 years, means I can say, means he taught me to be ecologist. And now, even in seed germination, even in two leaflets, I used to get so many inputs of ecology. Means there are so many things to study. So he taught me to be ecologist, and that's why when I will talk about the role model, then definitely without Professor Khan, no one will be, for me, means there will be role model or successful mentor. And besides that, I want to say a few lines about Professor Ganeshia. So I listened to him during 2007 in Nehu. He was there to taught us the mapping and quantitative assessment project, how to handle the project. And I listened to him and I was so excited. How come people deliver in such a way, in such an impressive way? So he is the person who influenced me to present any kind of work in front of the people in an impressive way. And since 2007, I met him in last 2017 in IIT Kharagpur. And again, nowadays I quite frequent to GKVK as well as ATREE. So we used to meet. And Uma Sankar, Professor Uma Sankar, he's an amazing speaker. He's an amazing speaker, I have to say. Means he never allow anyone to sleep. He never allow anyone to sleep. And means I even, a few days back I met Arun and I asked him, have you ever listened to Professor Uma Sankar? He was, I met him, I have a collaboration with him, but I don't know. I mean, you please listen to him and you will enjoy it. Means disseminating knowledge in an enjoyable way, that is really a commendable quality. And you are definitely Professor Uma Sankar as well as Professor Ganeshia. You both are role model for me. I always to be happy to listen both of you. And you both are really amazing Indian speakers. And about Professor Daya, I have actually, since 2007, I am associated with Professor Daya. So the best quality in Daya is like, means I know what is the level of my research, but he always encouraged in such a way like that I used to feel like I'm doing so big things. So the means he always encouraged to work. And that is again a best quality, because you see, all the students are never used to be equal. There are like highly motivated, there are students, they are coming from such a background, they never get any exposure. And people like Dayanandan, he used to encourage, means all the students from all the spheres. He never used to discourage, like, you can't. He always used to say, like, so you are doing excellent job. Yeah, I saw your work, you are doing good, you are doing excellent. Means it encouraged me a lot to do better. So that's why, means there are so many persons, but because these three person along with Professor Khan and Professor Bawa, definitely need not to mention, everyone is mentioning. And today we all are here to celebrate his this one leadership only. So I think that is sufficient enough that he is a role model for everyone.
I feel confident, Purvi, you've never put anyone to sleep. So now I think you can claim that for yourself as well. I thought we'll just continue with Mario, who was also being very modest in the beginning, because your student, when we were discussing who we should have on the panel, said you were a great mentor yourself and recommended that you should be on the, do this panel on mentorship. So I thought, since we've talked about really great mentors, let's also talk about in terms of, well, two things: how you've learned, what you've taken, how that's translated to you as a mentor, but also whether you've had any real difficulties in terms of mentoring, and whether what's been the most the hardest mentoring challenge so far, and what have you used to overcome it?
My students, several of them are actually here. These are questions for them, not necessarily for me. So I think for me, the role of a mentor is a lot more fluid than students necessarily realize. I think they don't necessarily know that their job is not just to be a student in that space, either as a lab or in the classroom, that the dissemination of knowledge is one way. I think that by the time they get midway through their PhD, they quickly realize that they bring more to the expansion of what we do than they thought possible. And I think that's my role. My role as a mentor is to let them know that what they bring is new things. My lab is bigger than it was than I ever thought it would be. Like when I conceived what I would be doing 8 years now, since I've started my lab, this is not it. It's so much bigger. It's because everybody has brought something new. And I don't think they realize that's their role until somewhere along the way. It's also tricky for me to be able to fine-tune the mentorship style, because very quickly I realized not everybody is a little version of me, and not everybody is a little is going to be an academic necessarily. And that should not be the end goal. Right? So to be able to identify for the student, sometimes before the student identifies it themselves, where their strengths lie, so that I can help them get there. Now, these are all goalposts for me, and really, you should ask the students in that corner whether I've reached these goalposts, whether I am harnessing the best versions of themselves, which I think is my primary goal, making them be the best versions of themselves.
So challenges
is knowing how to push, so that you don't push too hard, but you push just enough, right? Identifying before it's too late, and it's never too late. That's a terrible phrase. It's never too late, right? A student can struggle, but they can always find their footing. But for me to realize that I can help them get there, and they should be comfortable enough to come to me, is a tricky thing, right? I think a lot of mentors have to do multiple things. We're not just educators, but we're counselors, we're lab managers. We actually fill so many roles simultaneously, and it muddies up how your students and your project assistants and your postdocs see your role. So being clear and communicating, I think it is key. It's not easy. You wear so many hats simultaneously, and sometimes those hats are the wrong hats to wear.
So I'm actually going to skip just to change it. So you've obviously, among this group, worked the longest and probably had the most number of people that you've mentored. And you talked about how you were mentored, but I'm sure you've had, over this last 25 years since you did that PhD, many, many students who worked with you. How have you kind of assimilated those very nice stories that you said, and how's that translated to how you are, and what challenges have you faced?
Yeah, it depends on this class size also, because sometimes when the classes are small, it's very easy, and you get very close to them, and they also come with their problems and so on. But sometimes we have these huge classes. The small classes are the four-year degree classes, where they specialize in something at the end. And the others are general degree, three-year degree classes. But I don't want to penalize the big group and do the minimum and then let them go. Because I, when I came back from my PhD, after being in forest for 1 year, I told my prof, I want to take these students to the field, otherwise we can't teach ecology. And the existing prof said, yes, let's go to the VC and see whether we can get some funds. And when I learned, we were brought twigs and put into these water bottles, and then they show us a twig and they say, this is a horror species, this is something else, a dipterocarp species, this is something else. And we have no clue of what the tree is like. And you go to the forest and you see these giant trees, and I told my prof, I don't want to do that, let's take them to the field. So he took me to the vice chancellor and said, can we have some money for field work and so on. So 3 times we went, and at last the vice chancellor said, yes, she has been so persevering, I must give her some money. And we got the money. So I used to take these big groups. But as you say, in some in classes, always you have the enthusiastic ones and the less enthusiastic. And sometimes it's hard to get everyone's attention. So what I do is I divide them into groups, small groups. But each group has the good ones and the less interested ones. So they learn from each other, and they're compelled to learn because they are, we have quizzes in the night and so on. And also the fact that they are small groups, they pay much more attention. And at the end of the day or whatever period, I give them quizzes. And the group mark is given by adding up the individual's marks in that group, and an individual mark is what their own group is. So the whole group is interested to get the best mark, and they help each other a lot, and they communicate with each other, so on. And so that is one way I tried to really get the poorest studying students to come up. And even in the practical classes in the labs, I used to walk around and especially look at their books and so on, and make sure, pay a little more attention to them. So that is the way. And also when they get friendly, then I get and ask them about their family problems and so on. And they come out, and so that way it's easy to take them to the field, and the next time they are really, they are just in the school already. Like.
Okay. Do you want to add to that? I mean, in terms of you praised a lot of other people, but I'm sure you've been on the other side. And so how has that changed you as how, what have you, you know, the way you interact with your students and some of the challenges you've had?
Yeah, actually what happened, being a mentee, it's a quite easy thing. It means when still, if Professor Khan is around me, I used to feel so comfortable. Means if I will, hang out anywhere, means he will be there to push me out. So, but being a mentor, it's really a difficult task. And today I'm here, and one of my students is also sitting in front of me. So, being a mentor, it's really a difficult task because all the students used to come from a different background. Because all the students' neighbor used to be well motivated, as well as they have different perceptions. So in that case, what happened? Because you see, I'm teaching in a Central University of Jharkhand, that is a tribal-dominated state. People are mostly coming from very rural background, poor background, economically poor, and literacy rate is where literacy rate is quite low than the national literacy rate. So in that areas, actually most of the students, actually in Jharkhand and Bihar, people still are suffering from the their primary education is not quite good. Even people are, they are trying to opt science, but there is no science teacher. So they are bound to learn social science. Like that. Still, that kind of situation is prevailing there. So I'm coming from Assam, but our primary education or high school education is quite good. Quality education is still there in Assam. So what happened when I first joined here in the Central University of Jharkhand, because I was quite young, during 2012 I have joined. So at that time I used to feel like, means, how come this student, like, it means MSc student doesn't know a, like, it means dissection of a flower? That kind of experiment we used to do during class 9 and 10. Then one day I asked them, why you people are so poor? Means these are the works I'm teaching you in BSc, and this kind of work we used to do during 9, 10, 11, 12, like that. And in BSc, you people are unable to dissect one flower. What is the problem? Then they used to say like, ma'am, means how come, what is your percentage during your 12? They used to like 67, 68, 72. Then I was worried 67, 72% in our place is considered like quite high percentage, a good quality student. Then how come you were so poor? Then they told like, means the actual situation. Like in our place, hardly the practical exam used to be held. We have to pay 50 rupees and we used to be passing the exam because there is no science teacher. That is the situation. And I am now mentoring such kind of students. So it's really a difficult task. Teaching them from A, B, C, D to up to Z, it's really a difficult task. And another thing, like means you see nowadays we consider plagiarism. It's a quite, like we consider it like a scientific crime. Like, but what happened, those people coming from Hindi background, they are not able to write even in a simple sentence in English. And now we are bound, as a science teacher, we are bound to taught them scientific writing without plagiarism. So for that one, means we have to work a lot. Means I just tell them, you, because if I will say, go through these papers and take the this one, objectives, methodology, how they work, take the concept and do your own work. People are unable to take the concept. Then I used to tell them, better you do one thing, translate it in your Hindi, because your mother tongue is Hindi, better you translate it in your own language, and then you try to understand first, and then again you translate it into the English in your own way, then only we can avoid plagiarism. But you see, self-writing is a practice. It's not you cannot grow within a day or two. So it's a practice, like people who are doing from their childhood. So it's quite easy for them to writing a statement by their own. But writing others and making it their own words, it's still difficult. But still we are struggling. And I'm not telling like that. As I mentioned in the very beginning, all the students are from not the same background. Even though out of that one, means we are getting so many bright students. My first student is going to submit his thesis by 20th of February. So I'm so proud. He is poor in English writing, but he is a very hardworking field worker. Because of him, the Young Scientist Project become successful for me. And he is a very hardworking, he used to respect, as a mentor, he used to show so much respect. If I used to be lab up to 9, then he will never leave the lab. So, means that is the way, means they influence us to be a great mentor. Like means he is appreciating, like means I am giving effort to him and he is appreciating it and he is doing his hard labor. Still a lot of things to learn to him, but even though he is doing hard work and he is nowadays he is a good analyzer. He can do very nice scientific analyzing power, calculation of data and everything, but still he is a little bit poor in English, but I think we can overcome. We can overcome. I have confident enough about all those things. And regarding the MSc students, actually we had started with 5 years integrated course. At that time what happened, 12 pass out students used to come and we get sufficient time to shape up them up to their dissertation work. Like Keshav is sitting in front of me. He is one of my bright students, a very good student. And he is presently work with Dr. Rabi Kant. And I know he is not going to disappoint Dr. Rabi. So he is a such kind of student. And because we have cultured him for last 5 years, so it's easy for integrated student to shape up than the 2 years PG student. So that is the difficulties we are facing in our place.
I mean, really amazing, because clearly very, very different set of challenges. I mean, ISC, NCBS, very elite institutions, but this is a, you know, it's a completely different set of challenges, but yeah. Really, I mean, you're doing amazing work. So
thank you so much.
Yeah, really touched by what you're doing. Arundhati, we left you out, but you're the youngest. She was worried that I've not mentored anybody yet, so I said at least speak to us from the other side of the, in terms of challenges or something where you felt, which have been biggest challenges now in the kinds of, now I feel almost, I feel like this is almost first world problems on this side of the aisle, because I know, because I follow a lot of ISC faculty and we talk a lot about depression and so on, and then you see kind of the other side where, you know, talent is everywhere, opportunity is not, and so now I feel like we're talking about first world problems, but anyway.
It's
So on that note, I acknowledge the good fortune that I've had in my mentors, you know, giving me the freedom to sort of follow my ideas and also supporting me when I needed that, so responding on reports or manuscripts and giving me feedback when I needed it. And I think that's a difficult line for any mentor to sort of walk, you know, as Maria was saying, to up to what point do you, you know, step in and interfere with the process, and at what point do you, you know, step back and just let the student take their ideas and ownership and run with it. Yeah. And I realize, you know, it worked well for me to have that kind of freedom, but it doesn't work that.
Yeah, I think that's the hardest thing, because if you push too hard, are you being abusive? But if you completely let go, are you letting the student down? That's a really hard line to balance. Yeah. So kind of slight change in direction for the last 15, 20 minutes. So I think, I mean, the morning discussion, we heard a lot of good science, and people, you know, constantly, of course, we started off the morning about India's biodiversity challenges and how to solve them. So very mission-oriented discussion. And then we saw a lot of very good science. And then in the afternoon, a little more applied, you know, type of work. But, you know, confronting the kind of challenges that the science has to actually solve. We all face this in the work we do, which is we do the good science. And nowadays, there's a lot of pressure to actually say, does your science make a difference, right? Even your DBT proposals, or if it's in the US, the NSF proposals have this broader impact session. And I think that we all struggle with this, and I struggle with it with my own students, in the sense you want them to publish the good stuff, but you also want them to do the outreach work, you want them to do the applied work and make a difference. And I often wonder whether we are, where's the line between how far you push the students to do the stuff versus if our academia is continuing to only count papers, then are we kind of actually disadvantaging them by making them do all of this outreach stuff that we are now expected to do? And so how do you kind of draw that balance? Do you leave it to the student to say where their talent is, or do you kind of push? And I sometimes wonder, should I be pushing some students more? So I wonder what other people think about this. Where does outreach come in?
I agree that the incentives don't match the expectation in terms of having to do the outreach. And I think that is probably something that needs to change, and also picking up on something that Maria said, is that not all people who do PhDs will end up pursuing academia. So it's important to have, you know, have these different options for communication open, and to make sure that students know that it is important to develop your skills in communicating with all these different sections of people and you know, public outreach as well as your scientific peers and so on. But I agree that maybe something needs to change in terms of the incentives when it comes to outreach.
Maria, you want to reflect on, do you leave it to the student? Do you kind of try to be fair and balance it out?
I think what society rewards and what society needs is not always the same, as you were describing here, and I don't think it matters. The science that needs to be done well and cleanly and published has to happen anyway, right? And I think it benefits the student a great deal to engage in society in some way or the other. So, for example, it's formalized in my classes, where you create a layman's version of the science that we've been discussing, either as a documentary form or in a written form, but we do that. And it's not just as an aside, like, oh, by the way, let's also do this because we should. It makes you a better scientist to be able to communicate your science to people who are not necessarily reading the same literature you're reading or doing the same experiments you're doing. Right? So it actually really benefits the student. Right? And the more we do that, the more we engage with that formally in our training, the better it is for everybody. It makes our vocabulary better, it makes our engagement better. So I don't think I want to think of it as a mismatch. Some students are certainly going to be better at it, balancing both with poise and grace. And some are going to struggle. But so be it, right? We all have variation, and we just we just try and train our students to be able to have a conversation about science with non-scientists. It makes them a better scientist.
Actually, I want to switch the question slightly to you, because, you know, when we started off, Maria started off with a story about how her high school teacher inspired her. And you just gave a story about the exact opposite end of the spectrum, where you have schools where students barely have teachers, let alone something else. Now, do you think that it's a role of universities or people like yourself to therefore bring that excitement for science to school? Because I know that you have enough to do in your own university. I mean, your hands are already full. Yeah. But do you think that there's a role for PhD students or universities to then go and try to bridge some of that gap?
Actually, here I'm just give you one insight about our university, what we are doing. Actually, in our university, we are running one program, societal outreach program called Unnayan. Means development. So in that program, what we used to do, like, means, as I told you, the students coming to our university, their background is so poor. So what happened, our university is situated in a quite rural background, that is called Brambe, a very outskirt area. So what happened, so many people in and around our university, they are working in our university, like, what is called, security guard and all. So they are so excited to look at us, means, wow, ma'am is doing excellent, means this student is doing good. So sometimes if we bring some accolades, so it used to be appreciated by university, and they feel so excited. So then our university thought like that, why shouldn't we initiate one program, social outreach kind of program, like, means, you see, up to 5 o'clock we have our university classes, after 5 we have a hostel accommodation facility. And there are so many students who are very much interested to teach others, because they are facing those problems during their childhood and getting now a great platform, and they are trying to make some change in their own society. So in Unnayan, what we used to do, the nearby students, rural students, primary and secondary students, they come to our university by evening 5, and our interested students, like Keshav and all, they used to take classes for those students. They used to teach mathematics, they used to teach them science, they used to teach them English. And for your information, I'm just telling you, last year, two Brambe students who taught by our geoinformatics student, mathematics, and he brought, in the state level class 10 exam, he brought 99.9%. So it's a kind of, I can say, achievement. And that is a charm in between our students, like they used to do something for the society.
So your students don't complain, they are excited to do it.
Yeah, definitely.
They don't feel like, oh, this has taken me away from my lab. And
No, definitely not. We never pressurized anyone. It is up to you. And it's not like only students. Like, if I am free and I am trying to take, I am interested to take one class for primary level class 1, 2, 3, 4 students, then I can also take. So it's not like only students are taking classes. If any teachers are also interested, they also go and join, and they take classes. We celebrate, this was Children Day, 14 November, and we used to like distribute books, school bags, uniform, sweaters and all to the rural students. And that is not like we never pressurize any faculty, any students. If you are willing to give something, then you can give. So,
Dr. Savitri, you want to talk a little bit about this science society interface from your perspective?
Yeah. Actually, we don't have difficulties, because for the promotion of the staff, there is a section which says that activities like this are given marks, and they say what the marks are. And when we apply for promotions, that column has to be filled, and we safe mark, and then we have to pass it on and so on. So in that sense, we get marks for both. And all teachers, I think they want to make sure that they have those marks as well. But in addition to that, the Sri Lanka Association for the Advancement of Science, where most of the teachers are members of that society, and they have different groups, science group, mathematics and so on. And each section, they have their own programs for the schools. And island-wide, schools are invited. either it's art competition or it takes them somewhere for classes and so on. And they get a feedback from them also and teaching as well. And the other one is science education program, where the teachers in a university and with their senior students, we go out to remote schools, and then we have a weekend where the lecturers of course give the presentations, and there are practicals and so on. Practical things are also taken actually in all the fields, maths maybe, biology and so on, and the specimens are shown to the students and so on. So that is ongoing as well.
Do you think we can do better and do better than we are doing in these, you know, we've talked about science communication with kind of headings, since the next session is on science communication. Is there more we can do in terms of compared to what we're doing right now? Anybody? Yeah.
Actually, what happened, we are working in the field of ecology and conservation, and all the ecologists are aware that that one grasping grant from funding agency, it's quite difficult. Because they consider like ecology and conservation, there is nothing to do. They feel like that. Funding agency always used to feel like that. But we know there are so many things to do in the field of ecology and conservation. Because as we know, conservation as well, conservation science as well as ecology, they are the basics of whether you are doing molecular biology, whether you are doing biotechnology, whether you are doing bioinformatics. I think without the ecological information, doing bioinformatics, doing biotechnology, it's not possible. So that these two principles, both conservation as well as ecology, both are the base of the biological science. But what happened nowadays, because both the work, both the branches of science are field experiment based. And it's quite laborious, time-taking, because it's not a chemistry like taking a solution, putting sulfuric acid, putting something else, then you are going to get orange color. So ecology is not like that. So in ecology, what we have to do means we are setting the experiment, we are going to get the result after 2 hours. That is minimum. 2 years is minimum. So getting the fruitful result, it's need at least 5 to 7 years. And doing PhD for 7 years, even UGC is not allowing. So that is the thing. So in ecology, to getting output, we need more time. And again, you see wearing one apron, sitting in the laboratory, white color apron, people used to feel like I'm a scientist. And wearing one hunting boot, one jeans, and t-shirt, going to the field, it's look like labor, not like a scientist. That is the thing. So now our responsibility is like, means we have to make it like passionate, our students. We have to, that is our responsibility as ecologists, to attract the students. And the thing is like, means just come, do the experiment, see the effect of biotic and abiotic component, nobody is going to do ecology. That is for sure. So like Professor K.S. Bawa, he is known like an ecologist. But he is not doing like impact of biotic and abiotic component. He is working on reproductive biology. It's quite challenging, and it's like he means it's going to give a very good result. He is going molecular phylogeny. Like that means we are responsible how to attract students. Like means we have to do multidisciplinary research. And one thing, again, I'm using one term like multidisciplinary. Recently, I was presenting one proposal for DST PhIS program, and I told like, I'm in environmental science, we are doing multidisciplinary research. Then they question, no ma'am, excuse me, you are not doing multidisciplinary. You people from multiple discipline sitting in the under the same terrace. You people are nowhere doing multidisciplinary research. That is quite right. Even one is doing phytoremediation, another one is doing biofuel, another one is doing ecology. That is not multidisciplinary kind of work. It is a multiple discipline sitting under a same terrace like environmental science. So like that means I'm talking about multidisciplinary, means like I'm expertise in my department itself, like I'm working in ecology, one of my colleague who is working on phytoremediation, and another colleague who is working on the phytoremediation potential of the biofuel crops. So I think if we'll combine all these three, then it will be a great ecology. because Jharkhand is a state where we are suffering from this one mining problems. So there are lots of restoration work to be done. And another thing, funding agency used to emphasize, like, means why you are going running after this classical ecology, basic ecology. But I have one query: without doing basic, is it possible to do applied kind of work? Means if I am still struggling in the field of ecology, publishing one article even in forest ecosystem, it's a difficult task for ecologist. That has 1.87 impact factor. But for biofuel people, publishing article in a renewable energy, 10 point something impact factor, it's not even a difficult task. So what happened, like, we have to make it, means present our work in such a way, like we have to involve various kind of statistical analysis. We have to incorporate recent trends in the research, like geoinformatics, application of geoinformatics, doing ecological research, means application of molecular technology, like phylogeny, Professor Daya is working. Like, means if we will incorporate all the aspects of ecology in one work, then definitely why not we can publish in 40 impact factor journals. So that is the necessity. That is the need of the hour, I think.
I'm into that. Do you want to, I'm going to give you the last word before we quickly summarize in terms of how can we be doing better as a group. And actually, I did have one question, but maybe I'll ask just a couple of you to, which is specifically on mentorship of women, because we're an all women panel. Would you like to say, are there, because you talked about how hard you found it to go to the field, and essentially you said Peter Ashton encouraged you to do that. Have you found that as something that you had to build in some of your mentees, where you had to say, no, this is something that's possible? How is that? Are there specific special challenges with mentoring women?
I think in my time it was, and I will relate to you also an incident. My sister is a lawyer and she goes to the same area that I work in one of the forests. And I have never worn trousers till I went to Aberdeen and coming to Sri Lanka. It was Mary Ashton who put me into trousers. And because she said, you can't go to the forest within your lungis, and this is what you have to wear, and so on. And I was standing at the bus stand with my local helpers to take the bus to go to the field site. And the driver said, no, you can't get in here. And he said, you are in slacks and you are with all these baskets. We had baskets for collecting material and so on. And he refused to take me into the bus. And none of us could go in there. Then it so happened that my sister got into the bus, and the bus driver said, lady, do you know this morning there was a lady in trousers? And we said, we are not going to take you with all these buckets and all these other things. And she was smiling to us. And then she responded to the driver and said, she must also be going for some work. Why didn't you take her? So that was the attitude then. But now it has changed a lot, and actually women actually go to the forest and they do a lot of work and so on. And I don't think there are any obstructions.
It's much better.
It's much, much better. Yeah. And also the women actually like to go to the forest. Whereas we find it more difficult to get a young man to come and do research with us now rather than the women actually. And can I just say one more thing and let me go? So I want to actually share with you something that has been reverberating in my mind for a while. And it is what a young teacher in one of the universities, at the end of a felicitation, said. What she said was, ordinary teachers direct us along the right path, good teachers impart good education, but great teachers groom their students to become leaders and inspire them to seek their own path. They encourage them to discover their talents and provide a bridge which the students themselves can cross. And having crossed, facilitate them to cross joyfully. They joyfully encourage them to create their own bridges in the field. So I think I must also thank Professor Peter Ashton and Professor Kamal Bawa, because that's exactly what they did. And from their mentorship, I'm trying to do the same thing for my students. Thank you.
I think that that was such a great, yeah, that should be the last word. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Veena, and that was a wonderful panel discussion. Thank you, Dr. Savitri Gunatillake, Dr. Purabi Saikia, Dr. Veena Srinivasan, Dr. Arundhati Das, and Maria, as I said earlier, I cannot thank you enough.